Namaskar, good evening. You are watching Rajya Sabha Television. I am Smriti Rastogi with news tonight. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines. Saudi Arabia promises all help in India's war against terror. Prime Minister Narendra Modi holds bilateral talks with Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. Both sides agree on sharing intelligence on security, increased cooperation in the fields of trade, tourism and housing. Make in India rapidly taking nation towards self-reliance in defence sector, asserts Nirmala Sitharaman, underscores advantages of investing in aerospace sector. Aero India show in Bengaluru showcases fighter aircraft Rafael and Tejas. GST Council announces relief for small businesses, extends deadline for filing sales returns till 22nd February. Decision on cutting tax on real estate and lottery sales deferred till 24th of February. Government takes a big step in introducing interactive teaching, digital boards to replace blackboards in 7 lakh school classrooms and 2 lakh college classrooms in next 3 years. And senior advocate Harish Salve presents final arguments in Kulbhushan Jadhav case at the International Court of Justice, asserts India has hammered facts in the case while Pakistan has merely misrepresented them. Strongly objects to use of abusive words by Pakistani counsel. Our top focus tonight, Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman's visit to India follows his high-profile visit to Pakistan at a time when relations between the two countries are at an all-time low over the Pulwama terror attack. But experts see it as an interesting balancing act by the Saudi Arabian Crown Prince, who flew back to Riyadh after his Pakistan visit for a standalone trip to India. Although a very brief visit, the Crown Prince held extensive talks with Prime Minister Narendra Modi and also backed India's fight against terrorism.
Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman started his 2-day visit to India on 19 February. He was received by Prime Minister Narendra Modi at the airport, a gesture that signifies the importance India attaches to relations with the powerful Gulf country. In Delhi, the Saudi Prince was accorded a ceremonial reception at the Rashtrapati Bhavan, where he inspected a guard of honour. Ahead of bilateral talks with the Prime Minister, Prince Mohammed bin Salman spoke about the admiration he had for the Indian Prime Minister. He described Modi as his elder brother. The visiting dignitary also spoke about the historical links between India and Saudi Arabia, underscoring the contribution made by lakhs of Indians in the overall development of Saudi Arabia.
We represent around 80% of the Arabian Peninsula. It goes to thousands of years of history, even before history is written. So the relation between India and the Arabian Peninsula, it's in our DNA in Saudi Arabia.
Adding a new dimension to the historical ties, India and Saudi Arabia signed 5 agreements. These are in the areas of investment, tourism, housing and information and broadcasting. Further, to consolidate and diversify the partnership between the two countries, Prime Minister Modi and the Saudi Crown Prince held extensive talks on areas of mutual interest. These range from trade and investment, energy, defence and security to nuclear and space, civil aviation, renewables, counter-terrorism, community welfare and regional challenges.
आज 21वीं सदी में सऊदी अरब भारत के सबसे मूल्यवान स्ट्रेटेजिक पार्टनर्स में है. यह हमारे विस्तृत पड़ोस में है, एक करीबी दोस्त है और भारत की ऊर्जा सुरक्षा का महत्वपूर्ण स्रोत भी है. हमारे ऊर्जा संबंधों को स्ट्रेटेजिक पार्टनरशिप में तब्दील करने का समय आ गया है. दुनिया की सबसे बड़ी रिफाइनरी और स्ट्रेटेजिक पेट्रोलियम रिजर्व में सऊदी अरब की भागीदारी हमारे ऊर्जा संबंधों को बायर सेलर रिलेशन से बहुत आगे ले जाती है। हम अक्षय ऊर्जा के क्षेत्रों में अपने सहयोग को मजबूत करने पर सहमत हुए हैं। हम इंटरनेशनल सोलर अलायंस में सऊदी अरब का स्वागत करते हैं।
हम समझते हैं कि भारत में जो अपॉर्चुनिटीज हैं वो 100 बिलियन से ज्यादा हैं और हम चाहते हैं कि हम सऊदी अरब के साथ मिलकर इन्वेस्टमेंट्स को दोनों देशों के लिए फायदेमंद बनाएं।
In the wake of the Pulwama terror attack, both leaders agreed there is a need to increase all possible pressure on countries supporting terrorism. Prime Minister Modi called the Pulwama attack a cruel symbol of the scourge of terrorism and sought punishment for the terrorists and their backers.
Pulwama mein hua barbar atankwadi hamla is manavta virodhi khatre se duniya par chhaye kaher ki एक और क्रूर निशानी है। इस खतरे से प्रभावशाली ढंग से निपटने के लिए हम इस बात पर सहमत हैं कि आतंकवाद को किसी भी प्रकार का समर्थन दे रहे देशों पर सभी संभव दबाव बढ़ाने की आवश्यकता है। आतंकवाद का इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर नष्ट करना और इसको समर्थन समाप्त करना और आतंकवादियों और उनके समर्थकों को सजा दिलाना बहुत ही जरूरी है। साथ ही अतिवाद के खिलाफ सहयोग और इसके लिए एक मजबूत कार्य योजना की भी जरूरत है ताकि हिंसा और आतंक की ताकतें हमारे युवाओं को गुमराह न कर सके। मुझे खुशी है कि सऊदी अरब और भारत इस बारे में साझा विचार रखते हैं।
The Saudi Crown Prince did not mention the Pulwama terror attack, but said terrorism and extremism are common concerns. He also promised that Saudi Arabia will extend all possible cooperation to India and other neighboring countries to deal with terrorism.
एक्सट्रीमिज्म और टेररिज्म की बात है जो हमारे कॉमन कंसर्न है। हम ये बात बताना चाहते हैं भारत को बताना चाहते हैं कि हम आपके साथ हर तरह का कोऑपरेशन करेंगे, चाहे वो इंटेलिजेंस शेयर हो और न सिर्फ भारत बल्कि सारे जो हमारे आसपास हैं सबके साथ मिलकर काम करेंगे, जो हमारे आने वाली पीढ़ियों के लिए भविष्य रोशन भविष्य को सिक्योर करेंगे।
External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj also called on the Saudi Crown Prince during his brief visit to India. The leaders discussed ways to add momentum to strategic dimension in various fields, from trade and investment to defense and security, as well as regional cooperation. The maiden visit of the Saudi Crown Prince to India came at the invitation of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. The Prime Minister had invited him during the bilateral meeting between the two countries on the sidelines of the G20 summit in Argentina last November. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And in a boost to India's bid to get Jaish-e-Mohammed chief responsible for Pulwama attack, Masood Azhar, designated as a global terrorist by the UN, Saudi Arabian Foreign Minister Adel bin Ahmed Al Jubeir has said that any terrorist who supports and finances terrorism must be proscribed by the United Nations. Jubeir, rejecting suggestions that Riyadh was opposed to India's efforts to get Jaish-e-Mohammed chief Masood Azhar banned by the UN, he clarified that the Pakistan-Saudi Arabia joint statement on Monday calling for avoiding politicalization of the UN listing regime was not at all directed at India's efforts to list Jaish-e-Mohammed chief Azhar as a global terrorist. The Saudi foreign minister said his country follows a policy of zero tolerance towards terrorism. And Prime Minister Narendra Modi will be on a visit to South Korea beginning Thursday. This will be Prime Minister Narendra Modi's one of the last bilateral summits before the Lok Sabha elections. The visit is important from both strategic and trade perspectives, as Samsung has recently opened its biggest plant in India and many more South Korean companies are interested in investing under the Make in India initiative. Here is a
Prime Minister Narendra Modi will reach South Korean capital Seoul on Thursday. His itinerary on the first day of the visit includes an address to the India-Korea Business Symposium, inauguration of the India-Korea Startup Hub, among other things. The Prime Minister will also interact with the Indian diaspora in the country, who number around 11,000.
Though it will be a very short visit, barely 30 hours, but there is a packed program with a number of engagements scheduled with the Korean leadership, businesses and other stakeholders. The two leaders will make brief remarks to the media following their meeting. Prime Minister will then be hosted to an official banquet in the Blue House by President Moon.
Prime Minister Modi will hold a bilateral summit on Friday with South Korean President Moon Jae-in on issues relevant to regional and global stability. The discussions will include the POSCO steel plant in Odisha that had been stalled due to protests.
I'm environment, it's, as I said, that is much better than before, and also more transparent. GST, I think that the Korean companies think GST is a revolution. Your defense industry high-ranking officials will visit Korea soon after Prime Minister Modi's visit. Then they will talk with the big companies like POSCO and Hyundai Steel.
South Korea is keen on collaboration with Israel for its own satellite development. At the end of his visit, Prime Minister Modi will be presented the Seoul Peace Prize by an independent foundation for his role in enriching relations between Asian nations and charting a new path in maintaining Asia-Pacific trade and power balance. The Prime Minister will return to Delhi on Friday.
For the last 4 years, India and South Korea have developed fantastic relationship as far as trade and economy are concerned. And convergences are also being made as far as strategic issues are concerned. It will be interesting to see that during this visit of Prime Minister Narendra Modi to South Korea, in which areas and how many areas new relationships are formed. Because India has a potentiality to become alternative of China in coming years, and Korea understand this very well. Akhilesh Suman for Rajya Sabha Television with camera person Suresh in Seoul of South Korea.
And some more developments of the day. Defense Minister Nirmala Sitharaman inaugurated the 2019 Aero India Show in Bengaluru on Wednesday. A total of 61 aircrafts are on display at the biennial event that also has 403 exhibitors. Several thousands delegates, corporates, government planners and military brass from across the world were present on the inaugural day of the five-day event.
The 12th edition of Asia's premier air show, Aero India 2019, kicked off at the Yelahanka Air Force Station in Bengaluru on Wednesday. The air display started with a vintage Dakota aircraft, followed by formations of advanced light helicopter Dhruv and light utility helicopter Du-228, Hawk and HTT-40 aircraft. This was followed by the flypast and thrilling manoeuvres by MiG-21, Sarang team, Saras PT-1, Embraer along with Sukhoi, Boeing PATI, light combat aircraft Tejas, HTT-40, Sukhoi Su-30 MKI, LUH, F-16 Fighting Falcon, Airbus 330 and the mighty B-52 Stratofortress bomber, among others. The Rafale aircraft caught everyone's attention with its dazzling display of breathtaking moves. Defence Minister Nirmala Sitharaman made a strong pitch for investment and the Make in India initiative. She invited investors to capitalise on the ecosystem in aerospace and other sectors in India that offer a big market for defence manufacturing.
Defence Ministry ensuring that procurement orders are given to Indian vendors who either with their own technology or technology in association with a company, the original equipment manufacturers who can come from different parts of the world, start producing here. You have an assured market. you have an assured, in fact, a captive buyer in the Indian Armed Forces. And therefore, it is possible for you to achieve the dream of making India.
5-day aero show begins in Yelahanka of Bengaluru Airport. And the Defense Minister's call was indigenization of Indian Air Force and entire defense sector. She also calls upon various foreign companies to invest in India under the 100% FDI route.
The 5-day mega event began on a somber note following the death of a pilot during rehearsals. On Tuesday, two aircraft of Suri Kiran, Indian Air Force aerobatics team, collided mid-air. While two pilots ejected to safety, the third pilot lost his life. As a tribute to the deceased pilot Sahil Gandhi, combat aircraft flew at low speed at the Aero India 2019 air show on Wednesday. With inputs from Pantanal Mishra, Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
The Goods and Services Tax Council has deferred a decision on tax rates on real estate and lottery till February 24th. The council, however, extended the deadline for businesses to file sales returns for January. The due date has been extended till February 22nd for all states and February 28th for Jammu and Kashmir. Finance Minister Arun Jaitley said that because of the rush of filing of returns, the due date has been extended till February 22nd for all the states and February 28th for Jammu and Kashmir. The GST Council was also slated to discuss the reports of the group of ministers on under-construction housing property and lottery. Ministers from all states attended the meeting.
आज जो 3B की returns है उसका last date है. देश भर में उसको जो returns आ रही हैं जिस speed पे और हर घंटे में हजारों की संख्या में आती है, एक-एक दिनों में लाखों की संख्या में आती हैं, तो उस डेट को काउंसिल का सुझाव था कि 2 दिन के लिए और एक्सटेंड कर दिया जाए, 22 तारीख मिडनाइट तक. जम्मू कश्मीर में के कोई कुछ एरियाज में डिस्टरबेंस है तो उसको 28 फरवरी तक एक्सटेंड कर दिया गया है.
एंड विद दैट वी विल स्लिप इनटू अ वेरी क्विक ब्रेक. मोर न्यूज़ एंड अपडेट्स ऑन द अदर साइड, स्टे विद अस.
Watch the big picture with me, Vishal Dahiya, at 9:30 p.m. on Rajya Sabha TV.
Tales that inspire. Stories of social change. A salute to diversity. Promoting public discourse. Events that motivate. Inspiring the innovative spirit. Watch Rajya Sabha television documentaries.
Welcome back. A day after the International Court of Justice refused to entertain Pakistan's plea to adjourn the hearing in the Kulbhushan Jadhav case, India is replying to Islamabad's submission on Wednesday. The 4-day hearing is underway at the ICJ headquarters in The Hague, with senior advocate Harish Salve representing India. While India argued on Monday and Pakistan responded to India's arguments on Tuesday, India will reply on February 20th, while Islamabad will make its closing submissions on 21st of February. It is expected that the ICJ's decision may be delivered by the summer of 2019. On the first day of the hearing, India urged the International Court of Justice to annul Jadhav's death sentence and order his immediate release, saying the verdict by the Pakistani military court based on a farcical case and that it hopelessly fails to satisfy even the minimum standards of the due process. Jadhav, a retired Indian Navy officer, was sentenced to death by the Pakistani military court on charges of espionage and terrorism in April 2017. Pakistan claims that its security forces arrested Jadhav from rest of Balochistan province on 3rd March 2016 after he reportedly entered from Iran. However, India maintains that Jadhav was kidnapped from Iran, where he had business interests after retiring from the Navy.
Takes exception to being addressed in this fashion in an international court. Beyond saying this, I would let the matter rest, for I do not, and the Indian culture prevents me from indulging in similar language of invectives and insults. India believes we have a strong case, and so we have, sir, as the saying is, hammered the facts and hammered the law. As the old lawyer saying goes, when you're strong on the law, you hammer the law. If you're strong on the facts, you hammer the facts. And when you have neither on your side, you hammer the table. Bereft of a case, Pakistan has hammered the proverbial table.
And some more news, President Ramnath Kovind inaugurated the International Conference and Exhibition on Energy and Environment in New Delhi on Wednesday. In his address, President Kovind urged policymakers to come up with actionable ideas on the environmental issues. He said energy and environment are the major areas of concern in today's era of rapid technological development. Reiterating India's commitment to climate issues, the president said that India is committed at the Paris Climate Conference to lowering the emissions intensity by 2030. President Kovind also said that the government is committed to providing power to citizens at affordable rates. Speaking at the event, Science and Technology Minister Harshvardhan said that government is according highest importance to clean energy as it is the precursor for sustainable energy. Organized by CSIR, the three-day conference will focus on environmental issues, including conventional energy technologies, renewable and non-conventional energy systems, sustainable mining technologies, among others.
I would advise this August gathering to deliberate on development of eco-friendly technologies for green mining. It is important for producers and consumers of conventional energy to evolve more efficient and cleaner processes to ensure environment-friendly use of natural resources.
This international conference is being organized by the CSIR Central Institute of Mining and Fuel Research to provide a platform to the international community to deliberate and disseminate on various issues related to the subject and also discuss several research and development opportunities and pathways that could lead to a prosperous, sustainable and secure energy future for the world. Both the energy and environment sectors today are at a critical juncture. We have already boosted the research and development in these sectors by doubling the expenditure in last 4 years.
An HRD Minister Prakash Javrekar launched Operation Digital Board on Wednesday, which aims to set up one digital and interactive board per classroom in government schools. Additionally, e-resources will be made available to students for anytime, anywhere access. Digital board will be introduced all over the country in government and government-aided schools for students from class 9th onwards from the academic year 2019-20. Addressing a press conference in the national capital, HRD Minister Prakash Javrekar said that the scheme aims at converting a conventional classroom into a digital one. He said that the new scheme will work on emerging technologies including machine learning, artificial intelligence and data analytics and provide intelligent tutoring to students based on their personal requirements.
Digital board आज भी अनेक संस्थाओं में है, तो जहां नहीं है वहां वो लगाएंगे. डिजिटल बोर्ड में देश का कोई नामी प्रोफेसर उसमें लेक्चर भी देंगे, टिप्स देंगे, लेकिन जो वहां क्लास में टीचर है वो भी, क्योंकि स्टूडेंट चर्चा करेंगे वो सब सुनने के बाद, मटेरियल भी होगा, ट्यूटोरियल भी होगा, और स्टूडेंट चर्चा करेंगे, उनके सवालों के जवाब क्लास टीचर्स देंगे. तो ये एक फ्लिप क्लास मॉडल के युग में हम प्रवेश कर रहे हैं.
The Supreme Court on Wednesday fixed February 26th as the next date of hearing in the Ayodhya's Ram Janmabhoomi Babri Masjid land dispute matter. It will be heard by a 5-judge constitution bench headed by Chief Justice Ranjan Gogoi. On January 27th, the Apex Court had cancelled the scheduled hearing for January 29th as one of the 5 judges of the constitution bench was not available that day. The bench will hear the appeals against the 2010 Allahabad High Court judgment that said that 2.77 acre land in Ayodhya be partitioned equally among 3 parties, the Sunni Waqf Board, the Nirmohi Akhada and Ram Lala. And some more news, Robert Wadra appeared before the Enforcement Directorate in connection with the money laundering case probe. Wadra reached the Central Agency's office in Delhi in the morning along with his lawyers. This was a scheduled appearance of Wadra before the investigating officer of the case in a criminal complaint related to allegations of money laundering to purchase of assets abroad. Wadra skipped the summons on Tuesday, citing bad health. The ED case against Wadra relates to allegations of money laundering in the purchase of a London-based property worth 1.9 million British pounds, which is allegedly owned by him. Wadra has been questioned by the Enforcement Directorate in this case for 23 hours over 3 days of deposition earlier this month. And that's all we have for you in this edition of News Tonight. For more news and updates, keep watching Rajya Sabha Television. Namaskar. We'll be right back.